sermon today, the introduction, I'll mention an individual who's been a very big servant for a very long time. He has done a lot to edify the body of Christ, and that's Dr. Don Ward, who was, I'm not sure, he was maybe the overall dean at Ambassador College in Pasadena for many years, and also at Big Sandy, Texas. From time to time, he has instructed the ministry about the importance, usually when I've heard him, of expository sermons. Expository sermons. I was asked to give a sermon on a subject in Smiltena when I was there 2 weeks ago. The subject was the number 666. And the people in Smiltena wanted me to explain those verses of Scripture to them. And I wasn't willing to do that. Rather than do that, I thought it was important for me to establish some principles of understanding the book of Revelation. And the other reason I didn't want to explain that verse of Scripture is I'm just really not... There's several verses of Scripture there about that number. I'm just not really totally sure that I understand it. Now, I've heard a lot of people explain what it means, but I'm not all that convinced by their explanations. And anyway, all of their explanations don't agree. So I think the answer to that is still blowing in the wind. Dr. Don Ward. The importance of expository sermons. What is an expository sermon? The first time I heard him use the phrase, I was wondering what that is. So here's again from the online dictionary the definition of expository preaching. Actually had this two words paired together, more of a phrase than a word definition, but the phrase itself is almost as a word. Expository preaching. Now, when you think about expository, It comes from the word to expose, to be exposed. There was a time when I was first coming here to Estonia. I went to this place that they have here, this really nice fitness center where they had a big pool and a place to go swimming. And I went out to the poolside. And one of the guards there at the pool, I guess you'd say, I don't know, guards may not be the right word, but one of the supervisors there on the pool to be sure that things stay under control in the pool, came up to me. She didn't speak much English at all. That was probably 98 or 99. And she's trying to tell me, and she's obviously making reference to my swimming trunks. This is a very big problem. Big problem. I didn't know what was the problem. I'm kind of looking around trying to see, did I have a big hole in the backside or was I exposed? That's what I think about when you talk about expository, being exposed. Well, that is an important part of the understanding of expository, exposing something. But here it uses a different way of relating to that. Expository preaching, it says, also referred to as a systematic exposition, is a form of preaching that throws light. That's one of the things we do to expose, isn't it? Throw light. And sitting here, we had to throw extra light on myself and on our tour so that we would have proper illumination so you could see us on the video. This is a form of preaching that throws light upon the meaning of a particular text or passage of Scripture. Now that draws a distinction right there. We'll get to that distinction a little bit more in a minute here. But it throws light upon the meaning of a particular text or passage of Scripture. As throwing light, this term is more general than exegesis. That's a technical term you're probably a lot more familiar with expository and exposing than you are with exegesis. But they're somewhat related, and it's more general. It's broader than exegesis, which is used for more technical and grammatical exposition. The careful drawing out of the exact meaning of passage in its original context. So what we're doing is, when we give an expository sermon, is we are trying to give a more careful drawing out of the exact meaning of a passage in its original context. While the term exposition could be used in connection with any verbal informative teaching on any subject, the term is most usually used in relation to Bible teaching and preaching. The practice, it says possibly, originated from the Jewish tradition of the rabbi giving a Dvar Torah, that is explaining a passage from Torah during prayer services. Drops down here a little bit to another paragraph. And this is where, you know, when I read to you before, this draws a distinction. Well, here's a better explanation of the distinction between an expository sermon and a different kind of a sermon which you are more in tune with, or you encounter much more often. Expository preaching differs from topical preaching. So there's the two different kinds that are being talked about here. Expository preaching and topical preaching, in that the former, expository preaching, concentrates on a particular text, a certain text from the Bible, and discusses topics covered in that text. Whereas the latter, topical preaching, concentrates on a specific topic and references texts covering the topic. For example, the idea of a topical sermon would be an example of a topical sermon would be the one which I gave when we had a failure of the video system from Cincinnati. We couldn't use it. So at that point I had to do an impromptu sermon so that we would have something there at services. And I used a topical subject, not expository. I took the topic of first fruits and ran around to different places in the Bible talking about first fruits. We went Leviticus 23, I think we might have looked in the book of Ruth a little bit, in the book of Romans, in the book of 1 Corinthians 15, but we were following that topic around to different places throughout the Bible. That's a topical sermon. The contrast is an expository sermon will focus on a text and bring in other passages as they relate to that text. So today, in accordance with Dr. Don Ward's admonition from time to time for the ministry, I'm going to give an expository sermon which examines, and I have identified for my purposes, this is my choice, my identification, I have identified for my choice, my understanding, three different themes in the first chapter of the book of Revelation. I started out thinking I will speak about those three themes in the first chapter of the book of Revelation. When I had about two sermons done, and I hadn't completed the topics, I decided to reduce it, or the themes, three themes. I decided that in this particular message, I will try to cover just two of the themes that I identify in the book, in the first chapter of the book of Revelation. And we'll be knee deep in the third, because I can't even get very far, not even through the first verse, without getting into the third thing. So what I want to do here in this sermon, give an expository sermon examining two of three themes of the first chapter of the book of Revelation. As an expository sermon, we will obviously be spending most of our time in Revelation chapter 1. Now, I would say this about the first verse in Revelation chapter 1. Well, let's say not just about the first verse, but about all of chapter 1, the book of Revelation. It keynotes the book of Revelation. It draws all of the parameters about which we should be aware and think about in relation to the book of Revelation, and we should be utilizing the principles that are given to us in the first chapter anytime we look at the book of Revelation. Keynotes the message of the entire book. Now, as the book is written by the Apostle John, there's some similarity that we can see in the book of Revelation with the Gospel of John. Same author, same technique, we will see. And I say that because it's important that John chapter 1, verse 1 explains the purpose, really, of the gospel of the book of John. He doesn't restate it until he gets to the end of the book of John. But in a similar way, the book of Revelation, in the very first chapter, states the purpose of the book. It is immediately set forth to identify that purpose that he has in writing the book. We might say, right out of the chute. We say, right out of the chute. That's an idiomatic expression. I asked Hazel to look it up. I mean, I don't know how I used that, but I wasn't sure what the origin of it was. In Buffalo, there used to be a man who attended, I think his name was Ken Reed, but I'm not positive of that because I haven't seen him in a long time now and I might have forgotten his name. But he used to compete in rodeo, you know, and all kinds of horse and cow and riding and roping and steer throwing and so forth, kinds of activities in a rodeo. Really rough and tough kind of stuff. Well, he would do those kind of things. This expression, right out of the chute, is a rodeo expression. Apparently, it has to do more with calf roping than anything. And so, you know, when the event starts, the door opens, and the calf runs right out of the chute. And if the cowboy who's roping the calf is quick enough, he gets him right away and is able to throw him down. Got him right out of the chute. And you're being judged on the amount of time it takes you to throw the calf to the ground. John chapter 1, verse 1, he sets forth the purpose right away, right out of the chute. Matthew does the same in the book of Matthew. Luke does it also. It's not an unusual technique. Here in the book of Revelation, we find that right out of the chute, the purpose is being set forth. In fact, this is the first theme. I said, I'm going to talk about three different themes. I'll try to explain two of them well, and the third one sort of touch on it and get started on it, but we'll have a long way to go on that third one. The first theme is identified with the first word of the book of Revelation. Now, in the English, you have the word the definite article there, and we're not counting that word. Revelation chapter 1 and verse 1, here's this particular verse of Scripture. It is really filled with a lot of different meanings. So if we're going to expose this Scripture, if this is an expository sermon, we're going to throw light on the text of this Scripture. Let's read it. Revelation chapter 1, verse 1. The revelation, there's the first word, there's the theme, revelation. We'll talk about it more, but let's finish reading the verse. Of Jesus Christ, which God gave to him to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. He sent and signified it by his angel to his servant John. The original Greek word from which Revelation is translated is apokalypsis. Apokalyptus. That is to say, to disclose. It means exactly what we said casting light on something. It is a disclosure. Which it says lightens. It doesn't mean it gets it isn't relating to the force of gravity when it says it lightens. It is referring to light on the subject. It is casting understanding on the subject matter. As the lighten, or to manifest, to be revealed, or revelation. So that's really a confusing word to most people, isn't it? It is the name of, by the way, Apocalyptus or Apocalypse is the name of the book in some languages and in some translation in the English language. This is the purpose of the book, to reveal, to enlighten. And yet, for most people, and it can be for us too, it's leaving things in a rather cloudy state sometimes. Is it really enlightening us? Is it revealing? Now that's of importance because it does say this is the revelation, the revealing. And it is the purpose. We'll go a little bit further. We'll see a little bit more about that purpose. But it is the purpose of this book of Revelation to reveal, not to conceal. At least in part. At least in part. But only in part. In this verse, which we read, I listed four things which I thought were important to note in this expository message with this particular one verse of scripture will be expository about this one verse here for a little bit. Four things that I think we need to note. Number one, of course, and it is the first thing, is that Revelation, to use the syntax that Gerald Waterhouse used to use, Revelation is a revelation because it is to be understood. It is not called revelation because it is to confuse or conceal, at least to certain people. The second point that I'd like to note, I'd like for you to notice, is who the revealer is. The revealer here is Jesus Christ. It is written as though he is the owner of this. It's like it, written in a statement that says he's almost the property holder or the owner of this revelation. Jesus Christ is the one who owns this revelation. This knowledge that's going to be revealed here in this book of Scripture. So it says it's the revelation of Jesus Christ. So that's a very important thing, and that's the second theme, which I'm not gonna focus on entirely. I'm not gonna try to completely explain this second theme because it goes in a lot of places, and even a lot of places here in this first chapter of Revelation where we don't have time to get to it. So maybe when I get to Buffalo on the 6th of July, I'll talk about that particular thing, the second thing. Jesus Christ is the owner, the revealer. Now it says something interesting about that God gave this revelation to him. It's not his own revelation, at least it didn't originate with him. It says that God gave him the revelation. The word gave is in Greek, didomi. It's a very broad meaning, and it could be construed in many ways. We can't say that using the word gave makes it incorrect. But some of the meanings in here, which I would tend to think are more appropriate, it says that it was very powerfully given, struck with the palm of the hand, is what it says, part of the definitions of this word. So it wasn't just, I might give Hazel a little kiss as I'm leaving and just be mild and so on. No, I would infer that this is a very powerful thing, this revelation that was given from God the Father to Jesus Christ. And that's something to catch here because it says God gave it to him. Well, it's more than, I would judge it's more than giving it to him. And then we see that it is for his servants. Now that sort of segments the people who may read this and pay attention to it. And it reminds me a lot of what the Bible has to say in Matthew chapter 13. You know, Christ spoke on that day in parables to big multitudes of people. And his disciples came and asked him, "Why do you speak to them in parables?" He said, "Well, I speak to them in parables so they will not see, they will not hear, they will not understand," because the inference was they're not ready for it yet. Of course, the implication was, Ultimately, they will see, they will hear, and they will understand, but not yet. It says here, this is for his servants. Yes, it is very confusing to people who are not the servants of God. But as you are the servant of God, then it is for you to understand. It is to be revealed to you. And I can't say that I understand all of it. I know there are quite a few things in the book of Revelation I don't understand. But it is opening more and more to me all of the time, as I expect that it will to you also, as you are one of the servants of God. It is specifically for a segment of the population, and a rather small segment of the population at this time. So yes, it is confusing. It's written in all kinds of symbols and all kinds of things. And there are many people who have taken it upon themselves to read the book apart from Jesus Christ and to decide what it means. And then they've written books and treaties and smaller publications as well to explain different parts of what they understand the book of Revelation to mean. And generally speaking, they get it completely wrong. Completely wrong. Because it is given for his servants to understand. And there is a key to understanding it. That is that Jesus Christ is the one who has been given the revelation by God the Father, and he has to reveal it. I mean, it's written down here, but there's a level of revealing which goes beyond the written words that are on the page. And that has to be entered into. Interesting, for many, many years I've quoted the fact that Christ spoke in parables so he would cloud his meaning. I don't know how many of you saw the address by Dr. Benjamin Carson, who's Seventh-day Adventist, to the National Prayer Breakfast in Washington, D.C. And at that prayer breakfast was President Obama as well. But he gave this address, and he explained to everybody that Christ spoke in parables to make his meaning more clear. So I had to smile at that, because he's a very sincere man, but I think he had that part entirely wrong. So anyway, that's an important thing to know, that this is given to his servants. It's not given to everybody. The third theme, which we also find maybe related to a little bit here in this first verse of the book of Revelation, is the time period in which you can expect to see this book primarily fulfilled. It has a period of time in which it is intended to be understood. It is prophetic about that period of time, and we will find in here several places a bit of a mistranslation, but according to Peter's Riddle, I call it Peter's Riddle, nobody else does, but I've named it Peter's Riddle, you find in the third chapter of 2 Peter, where Peter tells us that every day, he's talking about the creation week, there are 7 days in the week of creation, each one of those days represents 1,000 years in the history of mankind. So, John, I'm confident, understood that this was not going to be fulfilled right away. And yet some of the translators have made it seem as though this book is going to be fulfilled right away. Translators translating it was going to be 1,500 years later when they actually did the translation work into English. See, around 1,500, we started in the Tyndale Bible. Of course, we had in the 1300s we had previous Bible by Wycliffe. And then in the 1500s, Tyndale. And then, a little after 1600, you have the King James Bible. So they were translating it quite a long later, quite a bit of time later. So that period of time is something that we'll be talking about more in this expository. Let's go on to verse 2, this expository sermon of Revelation chapter 1. I just call this next point the context, and we're going to go through a few verses here relating to the context that's being talked about here in the book of Revelation, the first chapter of the book of Revelation. Verse 2, who bore record. Now, that relates back to what we read in the first verse, where it said, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which was given by the angel to the servant John. John, when it says, who bore record, he's referring to himself. John bore record of the Word of God. Two things here it says he bore record of. So let's put a little bit of light on those. One is the Word, it says the Word of God. And the other one is the testimony of Jesus Christ and of all things that he saw. What does it mean when it says he bore record? Well, he wrote the Gospel of John, didn't he? And in writing the Gospel of John, he was bearing record. He was a first-hand source of information. He was a personal witness of the things which he wrote about in his Gospel. Now, this begins to enter into some areas here that are pretty relevant. It says, he bore record of the Word of God. And it's translated there to, you know, to sort of infer, the way we would read it, that the Word of God, he bore record to the Word of God. What it doesn't appear as a name to us. But the Word of God is a name of Jesus Christ. He's saying here that he bore record of the Logos Theos. Logos Theos is a name for Jesus Christ. I'll demonstrate that for you a little bit. Now, we're into the, here getting knee-deep into this second theme, which I said we wouldn't spend too much time about, and that is, who is Jesus Christ and how do we identify him? Quite a bit of it here. It is a theme of the book of Revelation. Logos Theos is the name for Jesus Christ. We find it in referred to in John chapter 1 and verse 1. Again, you know, John and Revelation, they have a lot of things in common. So John there in the book of Revelation writes about, in the beginning was the Logos. And here, Logos in John chapter 1 verse 1 is capitalized because the translator understood it was the name, one of the names of Christ. And it says, and the Logos, that is Jesus Christ, was with Theos, God the Father. And the Logos was Theos. He was Logos Theos, Word of God. So when we come back to the book of Revelation, chapter 1 and verse 2, he says, John writes there, I bore record of the Logos Theos. He's saying, I bore record of the life, the physical life of Jesus Christ here on the earth. And it should be capitalized because it should be the name, one of the names. And Christ has many names, as we'll see even here in this first book, chapter of the book of Revelation. You'll see a number of different names. I'm not going to get into all of those, but here, at least, you see the first one, the Logos Theos. So he bore record of two things. One was the Logos Theos, that is the life of Jesus Christ, and the second thing is the testimony of Jesus. Brian gave recently. Well, let me just say this before I go into that. Revelation chapter 19 and verse 13. You want to go there and look at that. Talks about the appearance of Jesus Christ at his return and the establishment of the kingdom of God just before we get into Revelation chapter 20, which is about the ruling and reigning on earth of Christ and his first fruits in Revelation chapter 20. But he says here in verse 13 of chapter 19, leading up to chapter 20, he, Christ, was clothed with a vesture, a garment, dipped in blood. Why? Because through his blood, you and I have redemption from our sins. So in chapter 19, verse 13, and we're getting up to what his name is as he appears there at that time. He was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called Logos Theos. Here the translator of the book of Revelation put Logos Theos as the name of Christ. Didn't do it in Revelation chapter 1 that we were reading. I think we were in verse 2, I think. Yeah, bore record of the Logos Theos. He didn't capitalize it, but it should be capitalized. I said, Brian, I started to talk about Brian's split sermon where he talked about sacred names. And there, and we'll see here in the book of, in the first chapter of the book of Revelation, and even throughout the book of Revelation, various names for Christ. Now, as I understand it, although I haven't made any study of it, sacred names groups believe that you can only worship Christ under one or two names. I think it's contrary to what we're seeing right here, because Logos Theos isn't one of the names that they recognize, as I understand it. I don't know, there's probably a large number of different groups and different beliefs, but in general, the concept is that you have to worship Jesus Christ under the name Jesus Christ, or else under the Tetragrammaton Jehovah from the Old Testament. But I think that's just a mistaken concept. There, you don't worship Jesus Christ through phonics and sounds. And you know, God created various different languages at the Tower of Babel. And of course, that inferred that those languages would be quite different. in the way that they express the name of God. Here's what it says in John chapter 4 and verse 23 about truly worshiping God. This would be both God the Father and Jesus Christ. Christ is speaking to the woman at the well. And he says, the hour comes, and now is, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. Doesn't mention phonics and pronunciations. If you're going to truly worship God the Father and Jesus Christ, you do it in spirit and in truth. And for the Father seeks such to worship Him. Also, Brian mentioned this verse of Scripture, Exodus chapter 6 and verse 3, and I think it really says everything. It says there, and I didn't know Brian was going to give that sermon, split sermon. I didn't have any input with it whatsoever. Exodus chapter 6, verse 3. There Christ is speaking to Moses. He's telling Moses that you're going to go down and confront Pharaoh and you're going to lead the Israelites out of the land of Egypt. And in that exchange with Moses, God in the burning bush, who was actually Jesus Christ, says, I appeared to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob, by the name of God Almighty, but by my name Jehovah, Yahweh, the Tetragrammaton, was I not known to them. And the name that he appeared to them, it's translated here into God Almighty, is El Shaddai. The original Hebrew is El Shaddai. Sacred names groups, I say, under the heading of us too, because I don't think we know it all. Us too. Sacred names groups have more to learn about the names of God. And so do we. There's an awful lot there. But I think they have made a big mistake when they see that, and I don't know how many of them see it, that it says here that he was not known by the name, that they say you must worship him by, and yet there is no doubt that those three will be in the family of God and in the kingdom of God ruling. So they couldn't be there if this was a requirement in worshiping properly. Second theme, which we talked about, is who is Christ and how is He known? Revelation chapter 1 and verse 3, then it says it goes into something also very interesting, because now it's saying something is revealed here that is going to be very important for you to know. Verse 3 starts out with the word Makarios. Now, we talked about the word Makarios in relationship to the Beatitudes. It means the blessing of eternal life. So it's saying here in verse 3, blessing of eternal life, if you read this, many people have read it who didn't have any understanding of it. Did they get the blessing of eternal life because they just read it? No, this is a sequence. And I would submit to you that all three of these seminal points in this sequence must be fulfilled. Blessing of eternal life, he that reads it, then that that shuts out the great majority of all of humanity, doesn't it? Because most human beings haven't read it. Secondly, those that hear the words of this prophecy. Well, there are different levels of hearing. You can hear it, but do you hear it with understanding? This is meaning that you understand what you have read. Not enough. That is not enough. Reading it, that doesn't get you there. Hearing it gets you a lot closer, but it still doesn't quite get you there either, because there's a third thing in the sequence that you must accomplish. Keep those things which are written herein. So it's the keepers. James says it's the doers of the word, not the hearers only, that we need to be. So it says then, it concludes this verse, for the time is at hand. What does that mean? The time is at hand. Because I would have thought, reading this over the years, that the time is at hand means that it's time for Christ to return. You know, I probably thought that. I'm sure I thought that a number of years ago. The time is at hand. Christ is going to return. But you know, it had already, whenever this was translated into the English language, it had already been 1,300 years, and Jesus Christ had not returned. Was the time at hand when John wrote this down? The time was not at hand for the return of Christ. It doesn't mean the time is at hand for Christ to return. It means the time is at hand when you can now read this book, you can understand what is said. Why? Because the revelation of Jesus Christ is being given to you as his servants. But then you have this responsibility. You must keep. There are things in this book which are being identified to you, and the time for those things was at hand, and you need to keep those things. That's the time that's at hand. Verse 4. John wrote to the seven churches in Asia, grace to you and peace from him which... Here we get more into this... this identification of Christ. I'll come back to this when I get to Buffalo next week. Which is, which was, which is to come. That's the present, past, future. But this series of things, we will find it, and we'll be able to support that by additional scriptures, is a part or is a name of Christ. So Christ is saying to the seven churches in Asia, grace to you and peace from him which is, was, is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne. Seven spirits will be explained later in the chapter here, chapter 1 as well. Verse 5, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness. That could be considered a name of Jesus Christ as well. If you're going to stick to one name only, you wouldn't use it. Who is the faithful witness, the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth. Who in the world? What? Jesus Christ is the prince of the kings of the earth. You mean Hitler and Stalin? Nero, Julius Caesar, Nebuchadnezzar, is he the prince of those kings? No? That's not the kings it's talking about. Unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in His own blood. That's who's sending greetings to you. Verse 6. Here are the kings that he is talking about. The prince of the kings of the earth. He has made us kings and priests. That's a dual office. There's a lot to be thought about in relationship to both being a king and being a priest, which you as the servants of God, the first fruits of God, are called to be. He's made us. Who did? Jesus Christ did. He has made us kings and priests unto God and His Father. And it says to Him, Jesus Christ, be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Verse 7. Behold, He comes with clouds. Every eye shall see Him, and they which pierced Him. And all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of Him. I won't dwell too much on this, but I think it causes some people to wonder. If you have any questions about it, we can talk about it. Verse 8. Here's some more of this problem in the second theme. We're talking about three themes here in Revelation chapter 1, which are important because they go all the way through the book of Revelation, and they're established principles that you need to understand as you read the book of Revelation. Here's that second theme: who and what is Christ? I am the Alpha and the Omega. It's like another name. More difficulty for sacred names. The beginning and the end, says the Lord, which was, which is, which was, and which is to come, the Almighty. El Shaddai, you might say. Revelation chapter 1, verse 9. Then John writes this. I, John, who also am your brother and companion in tribulation and in the kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was a prisoner on an island, something like Guantanamo, I guess, on the island that is called Patmos, for, here's the two things again that we read earlier in this chapter. For the Logos Theos, I was a prisoner because of Jesus Christ. The Logos Theos, the Word of God. It didn't capitalize it here, but I would submit to you that it should have been capitalized as a name of Jesus Christ. I was a prisoner on the Isle of Patmos for the Logos Theos and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. Testimony of Jesus Christ is identified as being spirit prophecy. So John is saying he was prisoner there because of his Christianity. Third theme, which I really want to cover pretty quickly here, but it's a very important piece of information, has to do with the time period for the fulfillment of the book of Revelation. This verse we're coming to, verse 10, is a much misunderstood and much misused book, a verse of scripture, I'm sorry. But this one verse, identifies the entire time frame for the book of Revelation. John says in verse 10, I was in the Spirit, that is, Holy Spirit came upon him, he was in a vision, on the Lord's day. Now there's a big misappropriation of the word. Lord's Day, because many people in the Protestant world will argue with you that this is a basis for worshiping on Sunday, because they have identified the Lord's Day as being Sunday. Is that correct? Is that appropriate? Or is that completely a mistaken idea? Well, John says, I was in spirit on the Lord's Day, and then he begins to relate what happened. I heard behind me a great voice as a trumpet. Lord's Day has a certain amount of translation option for the translator here. Lord's Day is a verse of scripture or a phrase from verses of scripture that occurs 72 times in 70 different verses in the Old Testament. It's invariably translated as the day of the Lord. And the notion that he was sleeping on Sunday is quite different from the fact that he said he was had a vision about the day of the Lord. Three different ways I would submit to you that this verse of scripture could be interpreted. First way, I think all three of them are valid. The vision came to John on the Sabbath day. Now, it might have been a weekly Sabbath. I would imagine that it was, but it could have been a holy day because they are Sabbath days as well. He was in vision on the Lord's Day. Now, I would support that because it says here, the Lord's Day. I would support that by Matthew chapter 12 and verse 8, because Matthew 12 verse 8 tells us what day Christ is Lord of. Matthew 12 verse 8. It's short and sweet. Son of Man is Lord of, doesn't say Sunday. Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath day. So if he was in spirit on the Lord's day, it was the Sabbath, not Sunday. You see, that verse of scripture completely states that Christ is Lord of the Sabbath day. Who's Lord of Sunday? If you go back to Peter's riddle, the first millennium, who was sort of triumphant in that first millennium? Whoever it was might be Lord of Sunday. Seems to me like the one who triumphed in that first millennium, at least as he viewed it, God took a much longer range view, but as he viewed it, Satan was victorious in that first millennium. And I would submit to you, it's probably the reason he prefers Sunday as his day of worship. But the first way to look at it is that, which we should look at it, is that the vision came to John on the weekly. Why? Because Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath day. Second way, the Lord's Day is a prophetic revelation of the kingdom of God. The weekly Sabbath represents, ultimately, at the end of 6,000 years, the coming of the kingdom of God. 2 Peter 3:8. We've already referred to it. Beloved, don't be ignorant of this one thing. Every day, that one day, every day, is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. Referring to the days of creation. God created the heavens and the earth in 7 days, and each day was for 1,000 years. Seventh thousand year period, the Lord's day, Lord Christ is Lord of the Sabbath day, it represents the seventh millennium, which is the coming of the kingdom of God. So when he says he is in spirit on the Lord's day, he's looking at the coming of the kingdom of God. The third way is the day of the Lord is a time of fearful destruction just before the coming of the kingdom. And the Old Testament is full of many scriptures about the day of the Lord, the time of great trouble. And so is the New Testament. We find in Matthew 24 that Christ said, except that those days would be shortened, there would be no flesh left alive. We're staring down the barrel of that gun right now. The day of the Lord is at hand. Isaiah chapter 13 and verse 6. Here's just an example of what the day of the Lord means. If you just switch that word order around a little bit. The day of the Lord is at hand. It shall come as a destruction from the Almighty. So, no, it doesn't mean this time frame, which puts it into three different prisms, you might say, three different projected images that come from this scripture. Weekly Sabbath, coming of God's kingdom, and a time of fearful destruction before the kingdom of God does not mean that John was in Sunday school or sleeping on Sunday. And it is not proof that the Sabbath day has been done away with. This has been an expository sermon, the purpose of it to cast light on the entire book of Revelation, to expose it. We've been establishing three themes, and I've only been able really to deal with two entirely. Theme one establishes that the purpose is to give a revelation. It is to reveal to the servants of God. The third theme is to establish the time frame for the book of Revelation. I'm unable to complete the second theme, which had to do with the names of Jesus Christ and who he is and what his responsibilities are, but we'll speak more about that next week.